I'm Richard Swann, Managing Editor for News for Europe, Africa and the Middle East. Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. This brand new video series aims to get to the very heart of leading news stories from across the energy, petrochemicals and metals industries. In this edition, our topic is Glencore. Earlier today, shares in the commodity giant started trading on the full London market after the year's biggest flotation. The shares are currently down very slightly on the offer price, but they still value the once secretive giant at nearly $60 billion. To find out more about what makes Glencore tick, I'm joined today by Joel Hanley, head of our European crude team, and Andy Blamey, who runs our metals team in Europe. Joel, Glencore is certainly a very active participant in the global oil market. Can you outline briefly for us a bit more about the scope and scale of their operation?
Yeah, absolutely. Glencore has often been a rather secretive company. It's been privately held and therefore hasn't had quite that need for transparency that we see in other companies. But what a lot of people do know is the history around the original founder, Mark Rich. Of course, Mark Rich, a very famous name in oil trading for many reasons, sometimes not necessarily the right reasons. He founded the company in 1974 and was eventually bought out by some of his partners in the early 90s when they renamed it as Glencore. In the oil markets, it's a fairly active participant, as you say, but they're not really focused on the physical production of oil. They store a fair amount of oil and they have a large tanker fleet, but it's mainly the trading rather than production or refining that interests them. They have some subsidiaries or shareholdings in various companies, such as a bunker ship's fuel company called Chem Oil, and various other companies, a Russian oil company, for example, called Rusneft. And so they have oil coming to them through these sources and through term agreements with oil producers around the world, or indeed from national oil companies. But they don't necessarily produce oil. It's not their main focus.
Andy, their metals business is also very big, but it has a slightly different model.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, their metals business, their revenues last year around $45 billion, around 30-31% of their total revenues, but it stacks up very well against mining giants such as BHP Billiton, for example. But their model is very, very diversified, both geographically and in terms of upstream and downstream. They started out as largely a marketing and trading operation, but they've moved upstream, so they now have stakes, either minority or majority stakes, in operations globally, North, South America, Europe, Africa, Australasia. And so their model is very much two-part. They market third-party production and their own production as well. They're very involved downstream in logistics. So compared to a large mining operation, which is very much focused on its own production, selling its own production down to the market, Glencore has a much more hybrid, different kind of spread. Basically.
It's interesting because in oil, particularly with the history of Mark Rich, there are a real pioneering spirit about Glencore. And Mark Rich, you could say, almost invented spot oil trade. Is there that kind of spirit of innovation as well on the metals and mining side?
In a different way, I think. I think that the way they've set themselves up, as I said, a kind of a hybrid operation, is there's no real equivalent in the metals industry. They say themselves in their prospectus that they don't really have any precise peer group that does exactly the same thing that they do. So they've come invented a company that covers a lot more bases than the more siloed approach of a lot of the mining metals companies.
Mm. I mean, the size of Glencore, it's not a surprise to anyone in the industry perhaps, but this company is really not a household name, and yet you look at the scale of it, it almost should be. I mean, why is that?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, it being privately held means it can be closely held. And there is a bit of a cliche with Glencore that it's the largest company that you've never heard of. As you say, while many people in the industry have, a lot of people at home won't have done. And I think that there's a certain secrecy around commodity trading in privately held companies that some people rather enjoy. And Mark Rich recently gave a very rare interview in which he said that he kind of wishes that Glencore doesn't float because it would enable them to carry on retaining some of those secrets that makes commodity trading so successful for them. In the past, the Glencore website was nothing more than just a home page and a phone number, pretty much. There was no huge information about them. And of course, this flotation has created an enormous prospectus of around 1,600 pages, which has let people in to a degree. And they're going to have to start filing results, and they'll have to be a lot more transparent. And that's going to be interesting because previously, most of the insights that we really had into Glencore was through reading things like court judgments in trades that had gone wrong. Online there are stories about West African trading where you can see some of their court cases and see some of the minutiae of what goes on behind the curtain.
I think, in fact, their very diversity has kind of lowered their public profile. They're not like a bank or a BP. They haven't had a high street presence. They're not visible. They're kind of everywhere and nowhere simultaneously, but they're involved in an awful lot of commodities that affect people's lives on a daily basis.
So how transparent are they going to become now? I mean, the flotation is going to make them a very different company.
It's going to be incumbent on them to be considerably more transparent than previously. Their IPO document, as we said, is 1,600 pages long. It's very long on detail of their various production operations. It's slightly short on detail on how they actually make their money, except in kind of theoretical terms. But in future, this is a massive flotation. They're going to go straight into FTSE 100, which means that an awful lot of people are going to be investing in them directly or indirectly, and there's going to be a lot more scrutiny of what they do. NGOs, there are a lot of NGOs who are interested in the mining industry in general. That again, there'll be increased scrutiny on their operations from that point of view, and I think in terms of sustainability and environmental reporting, they're going to have to step that up in a way they haven't had to before.
So these sorts of things are increased scrutiny from shareholders or NGOs, activists, whoever you like. Is this going to lead to a change of behaviour in the company?
It's a very interesting corporate culture at Glencore, from what we know of it. They are a very professional outfit, as they like to be perceived. I'm sure most corporate entities will. But in this day and age of slightly more casual dress in the business world, here we are in suits and ties. And believe me, at Glencore, at their desks, they're in suits and ties at the moment as well. Certain oil majors allow their traders to wear jeans and t-shirts these days, but not Glencore. Interestingly, not Trafigura either, one of the companies that was not part of Glencore, but certainly formed by managers of Glencore when they left some years ago. So the culture is one of professionalism and partnership. Previously, of course, until this week, it's been held. The shares have all been held by the traders and the workers there themselves. So now they're going to be receiving their payouts to a certain degree. One wonders if they can retain that talent. But I think there is a loyalty in a partnership sort of company. If we look at a successful UK department store, John Lewis, for example, it's called the John Lewis Partnership, and all of the staff there seem quite loyal to that brand. They feel they're part of something big, and I think that will probably be maintained at Glencore.
I mean, they do say in their prospectus that they may have to change their compensation structure to attract talent in future, because the IPO is a one-off in terms of a sort of a big bang where you can cash in. You cash in your partnership, you benefit from the listing of the company. That's not going to happen again, so they may find in the future that the salary package is going to have to be different, but they appear to be fairly confident that's not a problem.
And Joel, if I could come to you on just picking up on something you mentioned that Mark Richards said in this recent interview, actually. It's an interesting allusion to he wished they'd stayed in the shadows.
Yeah.
This is a company that makes all its money, or a substantial part of its money, let's say, some rather, from trading. Trading is not a very transparent business.
No, indeed.
Do we think they're going to be able to continue? Will their shareholders want them to continue doing what they always have been doing as a private company?
Well, it's going to be interesting to see, isn't it? Because the shareholders are buying into what's already gone on. They're buying into what they expect of a company who's made an awful lot of money in interesting circumstances and indeed in rather secretive manner. Now that they're a bit more public, is that success going to carry on? We don't know. So we'll have to wait and see, and we'll wait and see if other companies follow the same flotation line.
Well, that's a very interesting point, isn't it? I mean, Glencore is not unique. I mean, there's no one exactly like it, but in the oil sector, you've got companies like Vitol, Trafigura, you mentioned earlier, maybe even Mercuria, companies like this. They do very similar things to Glencore, as do Cargill and Coke in various sectors that Glencore operate in. Now, there are very big private companies around the world. They're all going to be watching this. Do either of you think there could be others going down the IPO path?
I think it's obviously an option, especially in terms of raising finance. Glencore IPO hasn't happened overnight. It's been on the cards for quite a long time. It may have been delayed slightly by the credit crunch the past couple of years. I think other companies will look at how it pans out for Glencore. They'll see how the share trading goes. They'll see whether, as we've said, there's an impact on their business, the way they do business in future. But it's obviously, it's a tried and trusted method of going to the markets to raise cash. And if people want to invest downstream, then it will be an obvious thing to do. But I can't see it happening overnight.
Absolutely. I think the nature of the commodities markets will define how soon we see any of these parties going in. The health of the economy naturally will, but I imagine that with oil currently trading at $111, that's a lot healthier place for Glencore to be were it $80. Of course, as I say, they're not particularly oil rich in sort of stock terms, but I mean, they don't hold any huge reserves. They might be exploring off in the Gulf of Guinea, for example. But that interest in commodities, of course, will sustain any charge of anybody else to do the similar thing that Glencore is doing now.
Right. Well, thank you both very much for joining me today. And that's all from this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. Please join us next time.